Hello all, this is an important episode of Dr. Talks, and today we have with us Dr. Lavleen Kaur. Dr. Lavleen Kaur is a clinical psychologist, and she, you know, is a clinical psychologist at Mind On Clinic Delhi, Indus Health Delhi, and at the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. You know, I've seen ma'am counsel so many students, and in her practice, she deals with patients from all walks of life. And, you know, dealing with improving the mental health of people is a great service. And this is all the more important during the pandemic when we have so many instances of people, you know, in depression, people committing suicides, and, you know, people in grave mental health issues. So, ma'am, thank you so much for agreeing. And, agreeing to share the important information with all our viewers.
Yeah, my pleasure. And thank you to you too for providing me the platform.
So, ma'am, I'll straight away, start with the questions, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thank you. So, ma'am, you know, like, we deal with a lot of students. So for all the students who are away from their schools and college hostels and, you know, are facing screens instead of their teachers and, you know, facing postponement of exams and all the other things, right, and there's a lack of connect, what should they do to cope with this situation?
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Nowadays, it's like all of us are living in a virtual bubble kind of a thing. So there is like a prolonged time when we are facing the screens, the tablets and the other devices. And because of which there is lots of stress and anxiety. And because the mode has shifted from the brick and mortar to we have shifted to the virtual thing. So obviously, with so much of uncertainty, exams being postponed, many of the students, like particularly I'm talking about the university or the college students who might be looking forward to graduation ceremonies per se, because I've seen kids being very happy and excited about it. So the learning objectives being changed, so many things happening basically. It is definitely going to result in lots of anxiety, stress, difficulty in adjustment, emotional difficulties, problems with the family members. So yes, there has been a significant increase in the mental health of the adolescents, kids, everyone. So the question arises is, what should we do basically? We are focusing on our youth basically. So I think first and foremost, it's very important that you should take breaks during your online classes. Because I've seen, I have been counseling students online, offline also now since last 1.5 years. So what I've seen is that they are having online classes at a stretch. So it's very, very, very essential to have break during the online classes. Exercising, yoga, meditation, basically trying to unwind yourself, that is very much required. Have a routine for yourself. Many of the students, they don't have a routine. So they are sleeping late, getting up late. So it's just putting everything in a haywire mode. So you have to have, and it's affecting their sleep cycle also. So scheduling the day, you should stay connected with your peers. So it's physical distancing. It doesn't mean emotional distancing. So be connected with your friends, be connected with your mates, your classmates, your peers, your friends. So that is really going to give you a feeling that we are in this together, basically. So apart from that, spending time with your family, that is very much required. Picking up on something which really makes you feel relaxed. Yeah.
And ma'am, so I want to take this forward and, you know, ask you that there are some students, you know, who are themselves suffering from COVID-19, or there's somebody in their family suffering from COVID-19 and they're taking care of that person. What will be the way ahead when these students have to deal with online classes?
Yeah, I know. But then I think over there, the question of online classes, I'll disagree with you over here. The question of online classes will probably can be put on a back burner for a while till the time they don't feel good, they don't feel settled and better, because physical health is, because it's really like you're suffering from COVID, you are struggling at your physical health front also, as well as the mental health issues will also come up. So I think first of all, they need to understand that it's very important to stay positive and healthy, take all the adequate measures which are required for COVID-19, any kind of infection you catch up. And apart from that, later on maybe, or they can inform their teachers, they can take help from their friends. Like nowadays, there are so many platforms like Zoom, they have Google Meet. And so over there, they can probably ask their teachers to share everything in the chat box. Apart from that, they can just talk to the concerned authorities also. So I think If you ask me this particular question, this is very,
So ma'am, absolutely ma'am, you know, here you've spoken about that, you know, when it comes to health, they should prioritize their health first. So in this case, ma'am, you know, as you spoke, talk to the authorities, talk to the teachers. So what role do teachers play in making students deal with this pandemic-induced stress when they're not able to attend classes or they're taking care of somebody in their house?
I think apart from taking being in the caregiver role, there are many other factors also which act as constraints to the smooth functioning of the online classes. Say, for example, last year when all this started, so I had many students calling me up that, ma'am, we are having panic attacks because we are not having any internet connection. So issues with that. So these trivial things, which probably for us, it's nothing, but many people, many students are not able to even connect. So I think the role of teachers over here is to first of all understand the mental health issues that students might be facing. And it's irrespective of the age, because I've seen small children, younger children also struggling with this thing. So teachers need to understand any kind of a behavioral changes which are coming. They may be, they should have open talks about the mental health, the possible problems as per the age of the group they are teaching. Apart from that, they can have regular pep-up talks with the kids. They can have closed group discussions. They can have one-to-one virtual sessions, right? So even if you're not able to meet your supervisor or a teacher in person, but I think you can always plan up something like this. Like we have PhD scholars, we have so many people out there who are like really struggling with that. Apart from that, you can have a positive pause. So positive pause is something when, say, for example, there's an online class happening and you see that the dynamics of the class are just changing and children are going down on the energy level. So maybe you can pause over there, maybe have some nice talk with the kids, maybe some, there are certain activities also, which I will not go into the details of, because there are many activities which teachers can actually engage their students in and which can help, really help them unwind. So this is how, and I think over here, I'm sorry, but you have asked me something related to students, but I think over here, the mental health of the teachers is also very important because they're also going through a lot.
Absolutely, absolutely, ma'am. And ma'am, when you spoke about panic attacks, I'm also going to talk about anxiety. So, you know, for example, if a student gets COVID positive and he's in home isolation, separate room, what should we do, deal not with the disease, not with the symptoms, but the anxiety that, okay, what happens if he gets unwell? What if he doesn't get oxygen? What if he doesn't get bed? What if he nobody is able to take care of him? And the same question, not only for himself, for example, for somebody in his family, whom he has to provide care, but he may be helpless. So how do you deal with this helplessness and anxiety of what may happen?
What may happen? Okay. So now see, the last line which you spoke was what may happen. So may is something which is like, there is a possibility. It is not something which you can say with certainty. Yeah, you're absolutely right that nowadays, considering the scenarios and what we see every day, so this is something which is very, very distressing. But then somehow we have to understand that worry and anxiety is required. An optimal level of worry and anxiety is required for you to go into a proactive mode. But in excess, everything is bad. So first of all, you need to change your thought patterns. You need to change your mindset. Okay. So rather than thinking about the worst case scenarios, what if this happens? What if that happens? Let us, so in another way, it's like forecasting that this is going to happen. So maybe rather than that, what if I don't get a bed? What if I am not able to procure the medicines? Let us, if we are not able to go on the, we are not able to go on the positive extremes, I would not even advise that, because it's not easy to go on a positive extreme. So let's not work on the extremes. Let's settle down somewhere in between. So even if I know that there is a possibility of such scenarios and such situations arising, so I'll try and see what things are in my control, what I can do, and how can I be prepared? Because see, this is something which more or less we can't predict, that who will go to what degree or severity of the illness. So probably being prepared rather than, so it's basically more of a problem solving coping rather than emotion focused coping. So I think that is going to help. And again, as I told you, since if you are in the caregiver mode, so then obviously you need to take a break yourself also.
So I'm absolutely, you know, I'm going to ask another question which you have already answered, but I'll still put this question. Is like, you know, staying at home during a lockdown can bring a lot of despair, boredom, feeling of getting jailed for some. How does one, you know, deal with such mental situation or this feeling?
Yeah, so many articles of late have reviewed that staying at home, particularly either during lockdown or during the quarantine or self-isolation, many people have started perceiving it as equivalent to imprisonment. So something like the jail inmates probably feel. And there is another term, cabin fever, which is like doing rounds. So cabin fever is like being stuck. Like be feeling stuck in a situation or being not able to move or being stuck from deep inside. So this can lead to many things like irritability, frustration, stress, anxiety, anger outburst. So see, we humans, we need three things. We need three things to feel good. So one is we need to be, we have the need to be connected, need to be productive and need to be in control. So what to be in control, to be connected and to be productive. So if we have these three activity oriented things, so definitely it will help us in sailing through these difficult times, right? And you have to be very, very clear about the emotion which you are feeling, because it's not necessary that if I tell you that, okay, fine, start doing mindfulness breathing. So it's not necessary that it will be a savior across all these situations. So one fine day you can do it. Other day you might not be feeling like that. So you can go to many other kind of techniques. So there are many, many breathing techniques. There are many mindfulness techniques, relaxation techniques, which can really help you. And there are many other ways also. So you can get stay connected, you can stay engaged. So this is how probably this will help you.
So ma'am, this is about a normal student who is, you know, like in a normal situation. But ma'am, we get to hear bad news around us. And, you know, if we have to deal with bad news, not only on the television, but of some relative, you know, who's passed away or a friend who's passed away due to COVID, what is the best way forward in dealing with this, ma'am? This is a very sensitive and a tough question. Ma'am, please answer so that it benefits all.
Right. See, the best over here, what we can do is let out your feelings. Let others know how you are feeling. Don't keep it to yourself. Listen, like say, for example, if you have a friend whose dear one has like gone away, so maybe you can be around, give them a listening. And you have to understand that loss is unpredictable, loss is shocking and difficult to comprehend, right? So rather than saying how can I feel like this, it's very important to be in touch with your feelings, because the more you shoo away your feelings, the more you shoo away those things, that will make you feel more and more distressed, right? Apart from that, there are certain, all of us have a tendency to imagine ways in which this particular scenario could have been different. Like I could have done this to avoid this situation. So I could have taken my mom at a particular time in a particular place that she could have been saved. So basically some situations, some scenarios, alternative scenarios to not have the situation we have in front of us. But these are derailers. Derailers in the sense that they don't help you heal. They are hindrances in the adaptive healing process. So we need to be very careful about any kind of derailers. Derailers in agar, I'll say in layman term will be like the feeling of guilt, shame, not doing enough, not being around, and the most important thing, survival guilt, that he or she went away, so why I'm here. So all these things are something. So basically it's more about being in touch with your emotions, being able to process through, and most importantly, before anything else, wanting to resolve this feeling as soon as possible. You need to let the feeling come, face it, comprehend it, and then maybe it will take some time. So that is the bottom line, right? So time is something which will help you a lot in that.
So ma'am, yeah. So may God bless all the people who are dealing with such a situation, yeah. And your tips are really going to help them all. Ma'am, another advice, we have senior citizens in our house who are most vulnerable to COVID infection, and they also face emotional or well-being issues. So how do we deal? What is the advice for them? And how does the advice to all the people who have to deal with senior citizens and take care of them?
Yeah. So over here, I would like to add on that it's not just about the senior citizens who have families with them. There are many senior citizens who don't have families with them. They're staying alone. They're staying in old age homes. So for them, it is like the world has come to a standstill. So, right. So for them, I think, first of all, making them aware of what's happening around them, making them curtail the intake of the news which they are having, because there are so many news rounds happening. Like off late, there have been cases where elderly have come up with panic attacks, right? Or the elderly have increased sense of anxiety. So I think that making them more aware of the statistics, the real facts, staying connected with them, either through virtual mode, because obviously now it's like virtual mode only. So staying connecting with them, connected with them, making sure that they have all the resources to sail through this. So a basic thing, like say, for example, somebody is having hypertension. So a mere fact that what if I don't have my medicine for hypertension? So making sure that they have all the resources available to them, that will be very, very helpful. So spending time with them, spending time with the family, we can ask them to engage in something which they really like. So maybe picking up on some games, some new hobbies, staying connected with their friends, with their extended families, or connecting to others, that is really going to help them a lot.
So ma'am, I'll take a bonus question before I go to the next question.
Yeah.
The bonus question is about use of social media. You know, is you know, going on social media a good idea at this time? Because we are all, you know, on a digital diet, they say. So is it a good idea to be on social media, or what do you think about this?
See, it's a good thing to be on a social media, but then as I mentioned earlier also, excess of everything is bad. So maybe you should be filtering the social media inputs also, right? So if you go through Twitter, if you go through Facebook and other social media platforms, so there is all kind of news happening around you, or you can see, and it does affect, it affects everybody, it affects me also. So I think we need to have a very filtered way of looking at the social media, right? Because there are people who are doing really good service out there, but then there are other news also, which is very disheartening. You see all those disturbing images also and everything happening. So I think that we need to curtail that thing. So at times we also say that just quarantine yourself from the social media for some time. So that is something which has to be taken care of. So I think,
Please go ahead.
No, that's what I was saying, that excess is bad. So if you go on, so if you already are going through some kind of an emotional problem or a distress, so all these things can actually reinforce or fuel up the negative things in your mind. And you can end up having depression, anxiety, or other kind of, and then also you can go into panicky mode about not being able to procure certain things. A simple thing like, oh, you are not able to XYZ diet because of the lack of oxygen. So that's why we can go back to your question where students feel that, or a child feels that, what if I am not able to get a... So all these things, they're interrelated. So probably when we talk about positive coping, so I think this also holds a very important place over here, that how do we look out at the maintaining factors of the anxiety and fear as well.
Okay, great, ma'am. So ma'am, without looking, you know, without being insensitive and without, being rude to people who are facing this situation, I want to ask a question as how can we look at the brighter side of life and look at the COVID-19 mm-hmm. induced lockdowns as an opportunity? Is it an opportunity to do something new? Please tell us about it.
Yes, absolutely. It is. Like, this is what I personally feel. First and foremost, we have learned to be disciplined about our health. We have been disciplined about our hygiene practices. We have learned how to differentiate between what is essential and what is not essential. So last year when the lockdown happened, all these online things came to a halt. So we realized that, okay, fine, we can survive without all these things also, right? Apart from that, we have absence of a simple thing like absence of the house helps. So we have realized that, okay, we can do things on our own also, which is like any other, it will be like, oh, end of the day that, okay, my domestic help is not coming. Apart from that, you are connecting with your families, you are connecting with friends. So there have been cases where there are number of family disputes. Disputes as in not anything external, but within the family, there are problems. So the problems have been resolved because you're spending time with each other. Kids are getting more time from the parents, right? Then you are becoming more and more productive also. So imagine you are able to do more in less time. Say, for example, going to the office in a chaotic rush hour and versus staying at home and working. So obviously it can save you. So then you have, you can get some me time. You can rediscover yourself. You can give your time to yourself. You can pick up on something which is like, okay, I wanted to do this since a very long time, but somehow I've not been able to. So yeah, this is something which I can do, or you can pick up on something else. So, these are certain of the things which are really the bright side of this thing. So as I, like, we can probably say that every blackout cloud has a silver lining. So over here also, yes, it is something which is like really sad, and we have had great losses because of that. But at the same time, it's always, it always has a flip side. So if you talk about the positive side, so definitely there are certain positive aspects to this thing also, right? And
Yeah, so great, ma'am. You know, we have covered a lot of important issues, you know, in all the questions that I asked, and you have answered them, you know, to the full satisfaction of all the viewers. And, you know, I think everybody is going to gain a lot from what you've told us. Now, as we come to the end, I want to ask you a question of hope. And that question is, if there would be one wish that you think should come true, what would it be?
See, I will have a very realistic wish. Okay, I would not put a wish that, okay, coronavirus should go to an end or it should finish off. So for me, it should be like, if we have to stay with it, as the science, as the research and everything is saying, so maybe we can develop some strategy in which we can stay with it, but still not be too affected by it. So we should not lose young lives. So we should be living healthy despite. So it should be as common as common cold, as simple as that. So I want that we are able to reach that point, and where we can see happiness and we can see each other in person again. We can just be in, see our loved ones. We can go out. We can have fun the way we used to have maybe 1.5 years ago, probably. So this is my wish for everyone. And I wish that everybody stays safe and healthy wherever they are.
Ma'am, that was a great wish, ma'am. And I hope it really, really comes through. And ma'am, you know, you have covered a lot of important points today. And, you know, everybody is going to gain, as I already mentioned. And you know, ma'am, this is a great service that you're doing for all, for everybody, you know, because usually mental health is a neglected area. And you know, having a focus on mental health and having, being aware about mental health and aware that if you are having a mental health issue, you have to get it resolved. So, you know, that is the biggest awareness, that you have to reach out to a counselor, reach out to a therapist in case there is any mental health issue. So ma'am, you know, I'm really thankful to you today that you took so much time out and you have answered all the questions, and you know, a lot of people are going to gain from this. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. My pleasure. God bless everyone. Okay.